بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين، آمين. In the previous session we talked about أعوذ بالله and بسم الله. Although we did not go into too much detail of the rulings, and this is only to remind that we won't even try to go into too many details of all the rulings that would come up, otherwise we won't be able to move forward at all. Because this is Quran, the source of every science and source of every knowledge. And of course, as much you go into the depth and the details of it, there is more to it. And it will, of course, prevent us from going further and understanding the message of the Quran in the, and the, basically the thing that we are trying to do is cover enough that will give us a good understanding of the ayah, the message of the ayah, the background of the ayah, and what is it that we benefit from this ayah. Surah Al-Fatiha. This surah, you can say, is an introduction to the Quran. Surah Al-Fatiha is an introduction to the whole Quran. And you can imagine that the surah that will be the introduction of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how great this surah must be. How much it must be filled with knowledge, hikmah, wisdom, as it is introducing the ilm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Mufassireen, by looking at the message and the depth of the surah, have said that the surah has the gist of the whole Quran. Imam Razi rahimahullah, one of the very well-known scholars of Islam, who wrote a great tafsir of Quran, which is in about 32 volumes, and a quick introduction to the tafsir, that once Imam Razi rahimahullah said that you can derive more than 10,000 rulings from Surah Fatiha. So some people sitting there doubted it, that this is exaggeration. From such a short surah, how could you derive more than 10,000 rulings and masail? And he was so surprised by their objection, or by them doubting Surah Fatiha having these many rulings. So he wanted to prove that this book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has more than anyone could imagine. Therefore he wrote that tafsir. In that first volume, he showed us the way, did not go into the details because then there will be no time to do anything else. He went into the details to show us how to derive rulings from Surah Fatiha, and the gist of it is that he has pointed out over 100,000 rulings that you can derive from Surah Fatiha, not just 10,000. Of course, in reality, when you look at it, 100,000 seems to be a big number, but not comparing to the ilm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, says in Quran, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا, He taught Adam the name of everything. Just take this much part of the ayah. عَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا, He taught Adam the names of everything. How many names does this ayah contain? How much knowledge does this ayah contain? الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا, He taught him the name of everything. Now you go into the details of what does the name of everything means. So, Surah Fatiha really is the gist of the whole Quran. And it's the introduction of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Accordingly, it's a great surah of Quran. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, narrated by Imam Tirmizi and Imam Nasa'i rahimahumullah, in their sunan on the authority of Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فِي التَّوْرَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْإِنجِيلِ مِثْلَ أُمِّ الْقُرْآنِ, Allah have not revealed any surah similar to Surah Fatiha, neither in Torah nor in Injil. Their whole books do not have any surah that could resemble Surah Fatiha. There are some other hadiths that go into more detail to tell us that Surah Fatiha is a special gift was given to this ummah. No other ummah ever received anything that will be similar to Surah Fatiha. So this is a special gift from Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. And let me remind you of something very special about it. We all know it, but we may not pay attention to it. We all recite Surah Fatiha at all times. Every salah we recite Surah Fatiha. We hear the recitation of Surah Fatiha when we perform the salah behind the imam. Never a thought would come to our mind that instead of Fatiha, I should recite something else today. Well, I have recited it a lot. Everything else, there is a limit to how much you can read that. And after that, you don't feel like reading it. But Surah Fatiha, subhanAllah, we read it so much, and still you would read it more than what you read it, and still you are never fed up with it, and a person would never think that I recited it too much now. Surah Al-Fatiha, as we see from the name of it, is the Fatiha, is the beginning. And this surah was revealed in the early stages of Islam. A question sometime comes about the surahs of being Makki and Madani. And this is how Mufassireen determine the time period of the surah. Surah Fatiha, not only that it's a Makki surah, in fact, as I said, it was revealed in the very early days of Islam. There are some hadiths that tell us that Surah Fatiha was the first surah that was revealed on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's an authentic hadith. The reason Sahaba consider this to be the first surah is, we know that Surah Al-Alaq was the first surah. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. The reason Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi majma'een called this the first surah, because this was the first complete surah that was revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some ayahs of Surah Al-Alaq, some ayahs of Surah Al-Muddathir, Ya Ayyuha Al-Muddathir, Qum Fa'anzir, some ayahs of Surah Al-Muzzammil, Ya Ayyuha Al-Muzzammil, Qum Al-Layla Illa Qaleela. Some ayahs of these surahs were revealed before Surah Fatiha, but as a complete surah, this is the first surah that was revealed as a complete surah to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some of the scholars say that this surah was revealed two times. Once in Makkah Mukarramah and the second time in Medina Munawwara. So it was revealed two times to indicate that this surah is not limited to one era or one period. The message of it is for all times and for every situation. So therefore, it was revealed two times. The surahs that were revealed before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's hijrah and migration to Medina Munawwara are called Makkiyah. And the ones that were revealed after the migration to Medina Munawwara are called Madaniya. Now, we need to understand, Makkiyah does not mean that it was revealed in Makkah, and Madaniya does not mean it was revealed in Medina. There could be a surah that is known and considered to be Surah Makkiyah, and when you open the Quran, it will say this surah is Makkiyah. But in reality, that surah was revealed somewhere else in Taif. Or a surah will say Surah Madaniyah, and maybe that surah was revealed in Makkah Mukarramah. The surah was revealed in Makkah, but it's called Surah Madaniyah. Why? Because it was revealed after the Hijrah. After the Hijrah, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went back to Makkah Mukarramah for Umrah, Hajj, for whatever reason. And at that time, if the surah was revealed there, it still would be considered Madani surah because it is revealed in the era of after the Hijrah. So basically, these are two different eras that the Makki and Madani is indicating to. Is not two different places. Is not geographical locations. It's the two different periods of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life. He was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you want to divide his life into different portions according to his Nabuwa and Risala, you can say that there are three areas and three periods that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went through. Number one, from birth to the age of 40 when he received the first revelation of Surah Al-Alaq. Then from the time he received the first revelation till his Hijrah, so from birth to the age of 40, then 13 more years in Makkah Mukarramah as a Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who had received the revelation already. Then after Hijrah, 10 years in Medina Munawwara. So these are three different periods of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, and they all have different backgrounds, they have different rulings, and each, if a person would know about a ruling and would not know in which era this rule came and at what time this rule was applicable, then that person may not be able to understand the true ruling and the effect of the ruling and how effective that is for us these days. Because there may be something that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in Makkah Mukarramah, but a different ruling came in Medina Munawwara. As far as recognizing the Surah Makki and Madaniya, Mufassirin have gone into the details, how would we differentiate between the Makki and Madani Surahs, and there are many different ways. There is no need to go into those details because I'm sure we won't be going through those details with that we open the Quran and try to find out which Surah is Makki and which Surah is Madaniya. But of course, Mufassirin have done all of that work, and they have not just for Surahs. There are books that have been written on this topic, where they even distinguish between the ayahs, that which ayah is Madani and which ayah is Makkiyah. Surah Al-Fatiha is one of the, of course, deepest surah of Quran Al-Kareem. Therefore, as much as we go into the depth of it, you would find more pearls coming out of this ocean of the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have placed in his book. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once he said to Sayyidina Ka'b radiyallahu, Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu, Ubay, I will teach you a surah today that no one have ever recited such a surah before. But I will teach you the surah not right now, before we will leave the masjid. Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu says, I was waiting now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would teach me that surah. And then I saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is leaving the masjid. He's almost out. I went to him, I said, Ya Rasulullah, didn't you say that you will teach me the surah? So he said, when you recite Quran, what do you recite? I said, I recite Surah Al-Fatiha. He said, that is the surah. Why did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught him the importance of the surah in this way? This is, of course, another topic by itself. The method of teaching that we learn from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What different methods that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used for teaching us, for teaching the ummah. And subhanallah, with all the different research that is being done on the most effective method of teachings, we will find that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used the most effective methods of teachings in those days. Nowadays we may say that use a projector and use this, and we use all technology. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, without having any of this, he used the best methods of teachings in those days too. And this was another method, one way of those methods of teachings. He calls who? See, this is, every point of it is very important. I'm not going to go into too many details, but since we talked about this hadith, I'll just point out a few things from the hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could have called Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu. He could have called Mu'az ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu. But he calls who? Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu, who is known to be أقرأهم لكتاب الله, the person who was most attached to the recitation of Quran. He was known for his recitation of Quran at the time of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows his connection to the Quran. So he calls Ubay bin Ka'b and he says, "Today I will teach you a surah that is the greatest surah, and no one have ever recited such a surah before." So Ubay bin Ka'b radiallahu anhu, who really loves the recitation, he loves Quran, so he really would like to know it. Now Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam makes him wait. Okay, I won't teach you right now, I'll teach you a little later. And then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not now, after he told him that first thing and he made him wait, he is not approaching him the second time and he says, "Ubay, okay, let's come, let me teach you." No, he just leaves. Now he's ignoring Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu to see if he really has the zeal of learning, if he is really looking forward to it. And he finds, yes, he has that thirst of learning. And Ubay ibn Ka'b went behind Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stopped. "Yes, you came to learn the surah, now I will teach you the surah." And through this, he made Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu understand the importance of the surah, that this is how important the surah is. In another hadith, hadith in Sahih Muslim, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting in the masjid. Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam came and he sat with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As Jibreel alayhi salam is sitting there, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hears a big noise from the heavens. Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam said, "Ya Rasulullah, hadha malakun nazala min as-sama lam yanzil qabluhu qat." This is an angel that is coming down from the skies, from the heavens, never came down before this day. This angel never came down. And he is coming through a door that was never opened for anyone before him. That angel came and he said with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Abshir binurayni utitahuma. I came to give you a glad tiding of two special noor that Allah has given you. Two noor that Allah has given you. Lam yu'tahuma nabiyun qablak. No prophet was given this noor before you." What is that noor? Fatihatul kitab, Suratul Fatiha, wa khawatim Suratul Baqarah, and the last ayahs of Suratul Baqarah. Then that angel said, "Whoever would recite these two things, for each and every letter that this person would recite, will receive something special from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For every letter of these that a person would recite, not only that he would get a reward, that you would get it for the whole Quran. Alif Lam Mim, you get 10 rewards for each letter. But whatever a person would recite of these surahs, each letter you would get some special gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that gift is wrapped right now, you don't know what's inside. On the day of Qiyamah, we'll go and see the gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have prepared for us, that He is giving us for reciting these two surahs, which means Suratul Fatiha and the last ayahs of Suratul Baqarah. Suratul Fatiha has many names. For example, Suratul Shifa, Suratul Salah, and we know it as Suratul Fatiha being the beginning of the Quran. Ummul Kitab, which literal translation of it will be the mother of the Quran. Ummul Quran, Al Mathani. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي. We gave you 7 ayahs that are repeatedly recited. سبعا من المثاني is referring to سورة الفاتحة that we have given you seven ayahs that are repeatedly being recited. And Fasreen say it has two meanings. One is Surah Fatiha, we know it's repeatedly being recited. But the second thing is, as we just said, Surah Fatiha was revealed two times in Makkah and in Medina. So it was repeatedly revealed. Sab'an min al-Mathani refers to that also, that the Surah, the revelation of which was repeated two times. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين. All praise belong to Allah, the Lord of the universe. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the beneficent, the merciful. Maliki Yawm Al-Din, the honor of the day of judgment. Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'een, you alone we worship and you alone we turn for help. Ihdina As-Sirat Al-Mustaqeem, guide us to the straight path. Sirat al-Ladina an'amta alayhim, the path of those who were favored by you. Ghayr al-Maghdubi alayhim, not of those who incurred your wrath, nor of those who received your wrath, your anger. Wal ad-dallin, nor of those who went astray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started the surah with his hamd. Alhamdu lillah. What does alhamdu means? Alhamdu means all praise. Hamd in Arabic language refers to thanking someone. But there are other words also in Arabic language that are used for thanking someone. For example, madh, shukr. These are different words that are used in Arabic language for thanking someone. So when you're admiring someone, you say in Arabic, madaha fulanun fulanun. Someone admired the other person. And the other word is shukr. So there are three words, hamd, madh, and shukr. But there is little difference between the meaning of these words. Madh is used when you are admiring someone, even if that person could be, that thing could be a dead thing. You could be admiring a pen. So this is madhul qalam. You're admiring a pen. So you could be admiring something that is not alive. But hamd will be admiring only a living being. Then madh could be for things that this person does not, that you never benefit from, that no one can benefit from. I admire someone's beauty. So that is madh of that person, that person's beauty. But I cannot do shukr of this person's beauty, because there is no benefit that I'm receiving from his beauty. So when we, in Arabic language, we can never use the word shukr for admiring someone for things that others cannot benefit from. For that, we have to use either shukr or madh. Then there is difference between shukr or hamd. Then there is difference between shukr and hamd also. Shukr is used for things that you personally benefit from, regardless whether others benefit from it or not. So shukr, I will use only the time when you have done some favor for me, I will use the word shukr. You help me, I say shukr. Thank you. And this is the word I will use at that time. But you help someone else in that way, if I want to use the word shukr, I will have to add some words that will indicate that this shukr is for helping someone else. But not just shukr is not enough. But if I say hamd, ahmaduk, that will be for any blessing that anyone, any favor anyone received from you. Whether I received it or not, it doesn't matter. For everything, so hamd is general word that includes all the favors that are done to anyone. And number two, for every good that you have. Two things that the word hamd must have. Number one, that Every favor that is done to anyone, shukr does not is not inclusive. Shukr is only for the favors that I received. So hamd is inclusive, which means all the favors that you did or you could do to anyone. Number two, hamd is when that you have any good quality in you. Even if it is something that I cannot benefit from, I can admire you for it. And I can use the word hamd for it. So now when we say alhamdulillah, compared with the word shukr and madh, what it would mean, all the I admire Allah. We can say I admire Allah for all the favors that He has done or would do to anyone, and for all the good that He has. Imagine how much does that include. For every good that He has, and for every favor that He has done or will do to anyone. This is what hamd means. And then hamd will mean that the one that you're admiring is living being, and this is why we don't use the word madh for it. That madh is could be for dead people too. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then did not say hamdan lillah. According to Arabic language, you could say hamdan lillah. Admirations belong to Allah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word alhamdu. The alif lam that is in the beginning of it, it tells us that this is called alif lam for istighraq, which means it contains all the types of hamd. What does that mean? That every good thing that happens in the world, and whenever a person would be admiring anyone, in reality he's admiring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm admiring a car. In reality I'm not admiring that car, I'm admiring Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created the means for that car to come into existence. So every hamd, every admiration, every thank goes back to Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether it's from a mu'min or a non-mu'min, Muslim or kafir. Anyone could be doing it, it goes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, because alhamdu is inclusive, it takes all the admirations, all the good things, all the favors, and even if it is from a kafir, but the kafir really is not thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't even know that he's thanking. We are saying that whenever he's thanking anything, it's going back to Allah. But he doesn't even know this. So would that count? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say Ahmadullah. He didn't start with this. That say Ahmadullah. I thank Allah. Say Alhamdulillah. All praise belong to Allah. If I would say Ahmadullah, I admire Allah, that would mean that I'm really admiring Him, and if I'm not in my heart admiring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that would be a lie. But Alhamdulillah, it's a true statement. Whoever would say it, it has to be true, just like La ilaha illallah. Even if a kafir who doesn't believe in it, he would say La ilaha illallah, even just to make fun of it, it's a true statement. This statement can never go wrong, can never be wrong, La ilaha illallah. Same thing, Alhamdulillah, can never be wrong, regardless of who says it. So Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, all praise known to Allah, Lillah. See the Lam in the beginning of Allah, there are two words there, Lam and Allah. Islam in Arabic language is called Lamul Istihqaq. Istihqaq means deserving something. All praise belong to Allah, which means Allah deserves all of them. They all belong to Him. No one else deserves any praising or any admiration. We don't deserve it. And this is amazing fact that we see it in this surah. Very beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that when people admire you, when people talk good about you, don't be too impressed by yourself. Just say Alhamdulillah. Allah has used us for some good work. He gave us some abilities. Now, He is the giver of those abilities. He makes us use those abilities for some good cause and good work. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, He gave me money. He gave me that wealth. then there are millions of people who have that wealth. He gave me the tawfiq and the ability to help a needy person with it. This needy person, he comes and he thanks me for it. If I really look at it with all sincerity, I haven't done anything good to this person. Really, I need to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who gave me that to begin with, and then he gave me the tawfiq to give this person and help this person with it. There are so many other people who could have helped him. They didn't, and Allah used me for it. So who should be really thanked for it? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us, uses us. He gives us the ability. He gives us everything. And then he gets us to get all the admiration for it. And not only this amazing, in Quran sometimes we find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala admiring people who would do good deeds. He gave us the tawfiq of those good deeds. He gave us the understanding of the good deed. Then he admires us for it. This is encouragement for me and you. This is to encourage us, keep on doing it. You're a good person. Just like when the father gives $100 to his child and he sees, he wants to see where his son is going to spend $100 at. And then he finds out that his son, he went and he helped a needy person with $10. He put $10 in the donation box in the masjid, sadaqah. He gave some other people, he gave a relative $10. He went and he bought some gift for his mother for $10. That says, mashallah. MashaAllah, what a good boy. Here, another $100. So he's admiring him for those, he's the one who gave him the $100. He's the one who taught him the importance of all of these charitable work that the son has done, and now he's admiring him for it. To encourage him to be on that good path. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to encourage us, he admires us. In reality, it goes back to him. He gave me the tawfiq, he gave me the ability, then he gave me the tawfiq. There are so many people who have more than I do, but when they don't have the tawfiq from Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala, they don't use it where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me the tawfiq to use it. So really, he all praise belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With this, if we look at it, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us tawfiq to say even alhamdulillah, this is another tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the understanding to thank Him and to praise Him. So many people who receive blessings after blessings, they never praise Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, they will have to pay for it. In Akhirah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you be grateful, I will give you more. وَلَإِن كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. If you be ungrateful, my punishment is very severe. That means not being grateful, not thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a cause of punishment. So alhamdulillah, it's a blessing by itself. Rabbil alameen. What does Rabb means? Rabba yarubbu Rabban. In Arabic language means to fulfill all the natural needs of something. I'm making it very simple. Rabb is to fulfill all the natural needs of something. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a human being from a sperm. Look at the background of it. Where did that come from? How was it made? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created that power in that sperm to turn into a human being. Now, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserves it, how He protects it, how that goes into the womb of the mother and then stays over there, gradually changes all the shapes and forms. How much care that must need for that sperm to become a human. And now as it's developing, not only that it needs nourishment, it needs protection. Allah is protecting it from everything that could destroy it, that could affect it, that could harm it. It's growing, taking some shape and form. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would hand it over to us at that time, we will not be able to control it. He makes it grow. And finally, it becomes a living being. Still it's growing in there, remains in there for some time. mothers still are not in the position of feeding the fetus. Allah takes care of it. And it's being fed in there. And now, finally, once it gets to the stage when it's ready to come in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send the human being into the world. And right there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala arranges for the nourishment of it. Before that, there was no milk. All of a sudden came. Where did it come from? How did the mother know that it's coming? It's from Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. So see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking care of all the natural need of human being from that stage. The one who took care of us in that stage and at a time when we were not able to do anything. Do you think He have ignored us after sending us to this world? Of course not. He is still our Rabb. That was to show us how Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala is our Rabb. What does Rabb mean? Same thing. A seed. We see a seed for me and you is a garbage. For a farmer, that's the greatest asset that he has. He takes it. He preserves it. He maintains it. And tries to save it and protect it. But at the end, he can do nothing more than putting it in the ground. After you have put it in the ground, if a week later you take it out, it will be destroyed. And now take it out and go to the farmer and tell him, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know that you have planted that seed over there. Take it back. You go back and put it again. He will tell you that this is garbage. Now throw it in the garbage. We can't use it no more. But leave it there. After some years, we will see fruit on the tree. But subhanAllah, from the time that it was planted there to the time when you start receiving the fruit, who is doing all the work on it? Who gave it the ability to grow that big tree from this small seed? Were all of these apples in that seed? Break it and take it out? Was all of that sweetness in that seed? Eat it, try it. It's Rabbul Alameen. Rabb. This is what we are trying to understand. The word Rabb. Who fulfills the natural need of everything in the universe. So Allah is Rabb. And this is what Rububiyyah means, the one who would fulfill every need. He knows. So now to fulfill the need, he has to know all the natural needs. So this is Rabb. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not just our Rabb, is not only my Rabb, is not just the Rabb of human beings, He is the Rabb of Al-Alameen. What does Al-Alameen mean? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have said, Rabbul Alam. Now let's try to understand the Arabic here. If He would have said, Rabbul Alam, what does Alam mean? The universe. Alam is universe. So then why Alameen? All the universes. Really, this is what it literally means. All the universes. This is the plural of Alameen is plural of Alam. And Alam means the whole universe. Why Allah, before going into that, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used plural, let's understand the word Alam itself, by itself. What does Alam mean? We say it means universe. That's true. But where did it come from? Alam, we call the flag Alam in Arabic language. Alam. Why? It's a sign. What does Alam mean? Sign. So every sign is called Alam in Arabic language. Al-Alam ma yu'lamu bihi. Alam is called Isma Allah in Arabic language, which means the tool by which you mark something. This is what Alam means. The tool by which you mark something is Alam. So now, this universe, the whole universe is called Alam. Why? It's a tool to mark the existence of Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَفِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ لَهُ آيَةٌ تَدُلُّ عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُ وَاحِدٌ Everything in the universe has a sign to say, there is one God there. Someone created me. You look at anything. Where did this come from? There is a creator that worked behind all of these things. Who created this thing? So alam is a sign to the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So many signs became alam. It's called ismul jama'. This is alam. Millions and billions of signs of the existence of Allah. That makes it universe in Arabic. That we'll call it alam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, instead of just using the word alam, Rabbul alam, he said Rabbul alameen, that if anyone would think, oh, there are so many different universes, this is our universe, and then there are other plants, and there's the alam of haywanat, and the alam of nabatat, and of animals are different alam, and plants are different alam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then I'm Rabbul alameen. Doesn't leave any room to exclude anything out of it. Doesn't leave any room for even a doubt to exclude, to be able to exclude anything out of it. Now, let's quickly look at the message of the ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this ayah, taught us how to admire Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala and the way of praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. When we said Alhamdulillah, we praised Allah. But what is my connection to Him? He is Rabb. And the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used Rabb, because this attribute is such. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has many attributes. Khaliq al-alameen, Hadi al-alameen. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attribute of Rabb is such an attribute that affects each and every being at every second, at every time. There isn't any time in our life that we are not in connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that attribute of Rabb. Before birth and after death, we'll still be connected to Allah as our Rabb. Everything, as I said, every being. Because Rabb is the one who fulfills all the natural needs of anything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a Rabb of everything, and everything is being affected by Allah's rububiyyah. But by Allah taking care of the needs of it at all times. So there isn't any time when we can say that at this time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rububiyyah is not working on me. A person is sleeping, but the system is functioning inside. Who's working on the who's making this system function when we are unaware of what's happening inside us? It's the Rabb. That's his rububiyyah. We see a simple thing. I'm wearing a glasses. How did I get these glasses? This will be enough to see the rububiyyah of Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. There were people in some other parts of the world. They did so much research on when a person's eyesight gets weak. What this person would need. Okay, he needs some glasses. How to make it? Make it out of what? Then we need a frame to hold it. How to make a frame? They made all of these things. I wasn't aware of anything. I was working. I was sleeping. I was busy with my own things. And they were working on making some glasses for me. At the end, I paid few dollars and got glasses for myself. This is the rububiyyah of Allah, making the universe work for the need of each other. This is the rububiyyah of Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he's every time there are things that are going on that are really benefiting us. This is the Rabb of Allah, Rabbul Alameen. So there isn't any time when we say that something is disconnected, not just human beings, anything is disconnected from Allah's rububiyyah. At all times, every being is being affected by the rububiyyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen is telling us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, we are glorifying Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the Rabb and who is the Lord. And he is the Lord of the whole universe. It gives me a great feeling that the one who deserves all the praise is my Rabb. And my Rabb is so great that he is the Rabb of everything in the universe. It's not that someone else has another Rabb. No, Allah is the Rabb of everyone. So now I'm connected to everything in the universe through my Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And he is very merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very merciful. His rahmah is for me at all times. So the reason he created me, the reason he brought me into existence is to show me his rahmah is not to show me his qahr. This is why Rahman Rahim is here, to show us that everything that is in existence and wherever you see the rububiyyah of Allah, that is really the rahmah of Allah. This is why the word Rabb, remember, the word Rabb cannot be used by itself for any human being. When we want to use it for anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to say the Rabb of what? Rabb al-Dar, the caretaker of this house, the one who maintains the house, who runs the house. Rabb al-Mal, the owner of the wealth, which means the one who takes care of it or who maintains it. But just general Rabb is Rabb al-Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one is Rabb al-Alameen other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We could be Rabb of one thing or two things, which means trying to take care of a few things. Maliki yawm al-deen. Malik, there are three words. Let's understand the words. In Arabic language, Malik means Malaka yamliku, to own something. In another qira'ah, it's Maliki yawm al-deen. This is why they write it without the alif, so you can read it both ways. Maliki yawm al-deen, the king of the Day of Judgment. Maliki yawm al-deen, the owner of the Day of Judgment. Yawm, in Arabic language, literally means that any period of time, could be a shortest period of time, any, even literally, even a second is yom, even a minute is yom, hour is yom, and daytime and night time, anything is yom. So period, any period of time is called yom. Then generally is used for a full day, 24 hours. But literally it means any period of time. Ad-deen. Ad-deen means judgment, recompense, when you pay for what you did or you get paid for what you have done. So either you pay or you get paid. Full judgment. This is why Yawm al-Hisab is called Yawm al-Deen. The Day of Judgment is called Yawm al-Deen when everyone would be judged for all the a'mal, all the deeds that the person have done. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word deen for this meaning at different places in Quran. The word deen is used for religion in Quran, but it's used for this meaning also many times in Quran al-Kareem. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّا لَمَدِينُونَ in Surah Saffat, that the people, the kuffar, used to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّا لَمَدِينُونَ, would we have to pay for what we have done? Would we be judged for what we have done? So this is from saying deen, madinun. So Malik Yawm al-Deen, the owner of the Day of Recompense and of the Day of Judgment. What is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us? He's telling us there is a day would come when we all will be judged for our deeds. And really, this is something that we need to understand. There has to be a day when everyone would pay for whatever he or she has done. This is the true rububiyyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the true rahmah of Allah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just. And they cannot be, it's not possible that the oppressor will keep on oppressing people. The oppressor will kill thousands of people, millions of people, and enjoy his whole life and will not have to pay for all what for whatever he has done. Our Rabb is adil and he is just. And there is justice there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make sure that the wrongdoer someday will pay for his wrongdoing. And a person, the oppressed one, the poor one, the one who couldn't do anything, he gets paid for whatever was done to him. It is only adil. It is only fair. We can't just let it go like this. So many oppressors, they enjoy their whole life. Nothing happens to them before they die. That doesn't mean nothing will happen to them. Maliki Yawm al-Deen. Of course, another very important question that comes over here is that when we say about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He's the owner of the Day of Judgment, why we say He's the owner of the Day of Judgment? He's the owner of every day. He owns every day of our life. So why owner of the Day of Judgment? The reason we say that He's the owner of the Day of Judgment, because on that day, no one can even claim the ownership of anything. Today I say, these are my clothing. That's my shoes. That's my house. This is my car. On that day, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith, no one would have even clothing on him or her. That day, I cannot even say that these shoes belong to me. Forget about kings claiming the kingdom. someone claiming a house or a car or a property, we cannot claim even the smallest thing. No one would even claim it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in another ayah of Quran, on that day Allah will ask, لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ? Who has the kingdom today? Who owns everything today? لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَارِ. Everything belongs to Allah. Who is Qahar? Who comes over everyone? Today you see every, in fact, the person who had more will be scared more on that day. The kings and rulers will be scared more than the normal person that day. That Allah will ask me, are you a king? That he's done. So, this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Maliki yawm al-deen. He is the owner of the day of judgment. Day of judgment, he will have the total. Even today, he is the full owner of it. Really, it's not that the ownership is less. But today, people are claiming it, and he is allowing us to claim it. He's allowing us to claim it. If a person would say, see in Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah belongs everything that's in the heaven and that's in the earth. So if someone will say, this is my house, can we say, you're going against Quran? Allah says everything belongs to him? No, he's not going against Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, different ayahs have said that admitting to our ownership, it's okay. He asked Musa alayhi salatu wa salam, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَى? What's in your right hand, O Musa? He said, عَصَاي, my stick. Okay, go ahead. Consider it yours. The same thing, my house. Go ahead. You can call it yours. I won't hold you for anything. But on that day, you won't have your stick, you won't have your clothes, you won't have your shoes, you won't have nothing. So no one would even be allowed to claim it that day. مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. You alone we worship and you alone we seek help from. نَعْبُدُ, we worship. The simple form of saying this would be نَعْبُدُكَ, we worship you. وَنَسْتَعِينُكَ, and we seek your help. But see, if you notice how we translated it, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, we translated it as you alone we worship. In Arabic, if someone would ask you, point out which word means you alone. That is bringing إِيَّاكَ before نَعْبُدُ. This is the rule of the Arabic. That when إِيَّاكَ would come, the dhamir would come before the noun, that means it is specific to this. So إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, you alone we worship. If it was نَعْبُدُكَ, we worship you with the possibility of worshipping someone else too. نَسْتَعِينُكَ, we ask you for help, but with the possibility of asking someone else for help. But إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, you alone we worship, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ, and you alone we seek help from. Now of course, there are a few things that we need to understand in this ayah. Number one is, what is ibadah? Number two, what is isti'anah, seeking help? Because of course, at this time, maybe some of us will have that question in our mind that we seek help from other people too. And iyyaka nasta'in, if iyyaka nasta'in means we seek help only from you, so is it wrong for me to ask someone else for any help? Brother, can you help me pushing my car out? My car is stuck, can you push my car for me? Brother, can you carry this for me? Or we ask people's help for a lot of things in our lives. And is it wrong to do that? According to إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, of course it's not wrong. So then, where do we get that meaning is not wrong? Inshallah, we'll go into this detail in our next session. We will continue from this ayah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the right understanding of His book and of each and every word of His book, and give us the true love for His Quran, for His book, that we love each letter of Quran more than we love anything of this universe. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين. I can take questions from here. Time-wise, as I said, it was revealed at the very early stages of Islam. It was as few ayahs of Surah Al-Alaq were revealed. That was the first revelation. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق, 5 ayahs. And then few ayahs of Surah Al-Muddathir and Surah Al-Muzzammil were revealed. And right after that, the surah was revealed. SubhanAllah.
مولاي صل وسلم دائما.